hear from you. I need a word. I need to hear from you. Amen. Good morning, church family. Thank you so much for joining us and tuning in today. Welcome to Freedom in Christ Ministries, 11 o'clock Sunday morning worship service. So glad that you are able to tune in with us today. And we will go ahead and open up with our morning scripture. Our morning scripture will be coming out of Ephesians 4, 1 through 7. Ephesians 4, 1 through 7. So if you grab your Bibles, your Bible apps, and please open up to Ephesians 4. We're going to read 1 through 7. Amen, amen. It is a beautiful day. This is the last Sunday of 2020. So I know we have something to be thankful for. We might as well praise him now for seeing us through, because he has seen us through, because tomorrow isn't promised. Someone may be praising him today that may not wake up on January 1st. So let's thank him and praise him today. Today. Amen. Ephesians 4, 1 through 7. The word goes, as a prisoner for the Lord, then I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received. Be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing with one another in love. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to one hope when you were called, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. But to each one of us, grace has been given as Christ apportioned it. Amen. Amen. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you and we praise you on today, Lord God. We thank you and we praise you on today for keeping us through this year, Lord God. We all can look back, Lord God, and see some things and see how rocky 2020 was. But we know, Lord God, we are here today. We still stand, Lord God, as your people, as your children. And we thank you for that. You kept us. You guarded us. We girded up our hearts, Lord God, against the enemy, Lord God. You kept those darts away from us, Lord God. Any arrows that were sent our way, Lord God, you reflected them. You sent them away, Lord God. So we thank you for that today, Lord God. We know that today we praise your name because tomorrow is not promised to us, Lord God. We thank you. We praise you. We love you on today, Lord God. We want to let you know today we love you, not because of what you've done, where you brought us from, but because you loved us first and because of who you are. Just because of who you are, Lord God. Just because of who you are. We know that we can look to the hill because that's where our hope comes from. We love you, Lord God. We thank you. We lift you up. We thank you, Lord God, for this service today, Lord God. We ask anointing over this service today, Lord God. We ask anointing over the speaker today, Lord God, that the tongue be blessed, Lord God, that the self be set aside, Lord God, and be filled with the Holy Spirit to speak your word, Lord God, your word and your word alone, your word alone, that the Spirit cut through some hard hearts, Lord God, some hardened hearts, and hear the word. And take the word in, Lord God, that the heart may be softened and moldable, that you may be able to use them, that you can come into their hearts, Lord God, into their souls, into their spirits, Lord God, and use them in the way that you called them to be used. We all have a purpose, Lord God. Let their purpose be revealed today through this word, Lord God, through this service, Lord God, through this ministry, Lord God. Let your word be revealed. Let your word be revealed, your purpose for our lives be revealed, Lord God. If they're still seeking, if they're still seeking you, Lord God, reveal yourself, Lord God. Show them that you are the truth, the life, and the way. Amen. Thank you, Lord God. Thank you, Lord God. Thank you. We just thank you, Lord God. We praise your name, and we lift this service up to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen, amen, and amen. We're going to have a praise and worship song now. So sitting at home, laying in your bed, come on, just get up. Get up. Stretch. Thank the Lord. Thank the Lord because you're able to get up and stretch. Because you have limbs, arms, and breath in your body to praise him. Use it to praise him. Amen? Let's praise and worship. Thank you. Bless that wonderful name. Bless the name. Things will be given unto you. Peace, love, joy, healing, happiness. They're all yours They're all yours. All you have to do is call on his name. Amen. Amen. It is now time for tithes and offerings. It's time for tithes and offerings. At this time, you're able to log on to our website at www.freedominchristministries.org and click that donate button and get in your tithes and offerings. You're also able to contact myself or Pastor Danny directly, and we'll be able to take those tithes and offerings for you. So www.freedominchristministries.org. Thank you, Lord God, for blessing us enough to be able to give back to you, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God, for just watching over us and continually sending your blessings down upon us, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God, that we are cheerful givers, Lord God, that we're able to give back to your ministry, Lord God, for the building and the betterment of your kingdom, Lord God. I pray, Lord God, that as Freedom in Christ Ministries, we are good stewards over these gifts, Lord God, and that we use them according to your will, Lord God. Amen. So we just love you, Lord God. We thank you. We thank you for the hands that were able to give. We ask double blessings upon those that weren't able to give, Lord God, that they may be able to give at another time. So we thank you, we love you, and we lift this prayer up to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. And we will have another praise and worship song. And after that praise and worship song will be Pastor Danny. Amen. Amen. Praise and worship, y'all. Praise and worship.
Presence of the Lord.
Presence of the Lord.
Presence of the Lord.
Yes.
I feel it in the atmosphere.
Can you feel it?
Presence of the Lord. Spirit of the Lord is here. The Spirit of the Lord is here.
Amen, amen, amen. Good morning, everybody. Good morning, good morning, good morning. It's always wonderful to be in the house of the Lord, to come together and worship. Though we are worshiping apart, we are together. Amen. We are going to continue to study the book of Job today. Last week we started with the book of Job. So I'm praying that everyone has their Bible and their notes from last week so that we can all be on one accord as we move forward this week. Amen. Amen. Let us just open in prayer. Heavenly Father, we just thank you right now for all that you have done, Lord Jesus, and that all that you will do in our lives. Father, we pray for an understanding, Father. We pray for revelation. We pray, Father, that the things that are meant for us to know, Father, that you will reveal them in no uncertain terms, Father, that we would know that this information is coming directly from you, Father. We pray right now, Father, over this service, Father. We pray right now that as I deliver your word, Father, that you would remove me from this, Father, and fill me with your Holy Spirit. And that each and every word that is uttered out of my mouth, Father, would be holy and pleasing unto you, Father. That the people who receive this message right now, Father, would receive it on a yearning heart, Father. That they would be eager to receive your word, Father, and that they would test and believe, Father. Test and believe. The word says, Father, that the Spirit will test the Spirit, Father, and we pray right now that each and every person who hears this word, Father, would go and look and search for themselves, Father, and not just rely on the speaker, Father. That each and every person would have a direct relationship with you and trust and believe that you would guide them, Father, in the way that they should be guided. We're praying right now for those who are sick and shut in, Father, those who are afflicted, those, Father, who may be incarcerated, Father, whether it is incarceration in the physical or incarceration of the spirit and mind, Father. We pray right now of your releasing right now, Father. We pray right now for the healing, Father, the healing power that only you have, Father. We've seen over the past year, Father, all of the things the doctors in the world have tried to do, Father, in the process of healing, Father. And we've come to understand, Father, that only you have the healing power. So we pray that power right now over all of those that are afflicted, not just with COVID today, Father, but cancer and diabetes and all the other things that plague our bodies, Father, that have been happening for years, Father. Let us not turn away from those, Father. We ask for healing for everything that is afflicting us. And we lift this prayer to you in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Amen. So this morning scripture is going to come from Job 19. We're going to be reading verses 23 through 27. Job 19, 23 through 27. We're going to ask that everyone turn there with us. And this is where we'll pick up from where we were last week. Now, remember, last week we actually just kind of did the surface story of Job. We read that Job was this great man. He was upright and blameless. And one day the devil went before God, and God asked Satan, he said, "Have you tried this one?" Speaking of Job, he said, "Have you tried my servant Job?" And Satan said, "Well, of course Job is going to be loyal to you because he's got everything." And God allowed Satan to take everything that Job had, just not to harm him. And so with everything happening, Job lost everything. He lost his children. And when you read the story, it says that he received four messages, and all back to back to back were all messages of calamity. And he did not curse God to his face as Satan had predicted he would do. And so Satan goes back before God and says, well, if he suffered any physical harm, if he suffered, he would surely curse you to your face. And God says, well, do as you will, just don't kill him. And so Satan causes these sores all over Job's body. It says from the crown of his head to the soles of his feet that he had all of these sores. So he began to suffer. And in his suffering, his friends heard of what was happening to him in his life, and they all made the journey to where he was. And the story goes on and says that they sat with him for 7 days while through his mourning period, and then they began to speak their words of wisdom. Notice the air quotation, wisdom. And they began to tell Job that everything that's happening to him must be his fault, that he or his family sinned, and this was a direct result of their sin. And this went on back and forth and back and forth, and Job defended his position that he had not sinned. And it went on until God spoke, and God spoke, and he challenged them all, basically. He said that, who are they to try to figure out why these things are happening to Job? And then as we went on and towards the end of the sermon, then we came to understand that Job remained faithful through all that happened, and God restored everything that he lost double. But one thing that we took from it at the very end was that God never explained to Job why he went through what he went through. But he made it clear that man has not the capacity to understand the things of God. And so here we are now, and we're picking up on it. And in Job 19:23-27 says that, oh, that my words were recorded, that they were written on a scroll. Oh, that my words were recorded, that they were written on a scroll, that they were inscribed with an iron tool on lead, or engraved in rock forever. I know that my Redeemer lives, and that in the end he will stand on the earth. And after my skin has been destroyed, yet in my flesh I will see God. I myself will see him with my own eyes, I and not another. How my heart yearns within me. May the Lord add a blessing to the readers, hearers, and doers of his most holy word. I'd also like to read that from the King James Version. That was the NIV. Let me read that again from the King James Version. And it says, oh, that my words were now written. Oh, that they were printed in a book. That they were graven with an iron pen and lead and rock forever. For I know that my Redeemer liveth, and that he shall stand on the latter day upon the earth. And though after my skin worms destroy this body, yet in my flesh shall I see God, whom I shall see for myself, and mine eyes shall behold, and not another, though my reins be consumed within me. Job has a faith beyond our comprehension to this day. You see, we say we have faith, and yet there are many times in our lives where we do exactly what Job's friends attempted. When we read the first chapter of the book of Job, we learned of all the calamity and everything that Job endured while maintaining his innocence. And as I said last week, we, the readers of the book of Job, have an advantage because we know where this started. We know that this was a spiritual battle. So as we're reading this, we know something that Job and his friends did not know. But Job remained righteous in this situation. He remained righteous. He did not curse God as Satan implied he would, or his wife suggested he should. He continued to trust in God through it all. When I was first given this revelation, I was just recovering from COVID. And I was out. It was actually the very first time I had been out since contracting it. And I was out running some errands. And while I was in my car at a stoplight, there was a man in a passenger seat of a truck that was behind me, and I could see him in my rearview mirror. And as I was looking, I looked, and I saw him taking these labored breaths, deep labored breaths, almost like he was on a ventilator. And immediately it came to me, and I began to praise God. You see, because something was revealed to me in that instant that with everything that I thought, everything that I had gone through, not thought, I knew I went through it. It was real. But with everything that I went through during the weeks that I had the COVID, it could have been worse. It could have been worse. You see, there are people who did not recover. There are people who fell ill and were ill much longer than me, who some required hospitalization. I just saw in the news this week that one of the first people who survived COVID just recently got a medical bill for $1.1 million for his hospital stay. You see, I did not go to the hospital except for the initial emergency room. So I can say honestly say that it could have been worse for me. Everything I went through, there were people that were going through worse. It said that Job was the greatest man in the East. And so I had the question, if it was very specific about him being the greatest in the East, was there someone that was greater than him, maybe in the West or in the North or the South? And at the time that Job was going through the things that he was going through, could there have been someone who was going through more? Could there have been someone who was suffering greater than Job? Now, I understand that the story of Job is very specific because it tells of Job's faithfulness. It tells of Job's patience. And so we understand the story of Job itself. But then when you have to really dig down and to try to get somewhat of an understanding of the magnitude of what happened with Job, you have to also think that maybe there was someone who didn't suffer as bad as Job, but maybe there was someone who suffered more than Job. You see, God made it clear to Job and his friends that the things that are happening, the things that I do are beyond your comprehension. So when we look at today, this pandemic, we know that the fallout from this pandemic has made the story of Job more relevant to us now than ever. No one can doubt the untold hardship that has been brought on by COVID-19. And this has been experienced by people all over the world. So when you look at daily, you see the news and you see them break down into regions. Who was hit hardest with COVID today? Who suffered the most deaths from COVID today? You see this. And it moves from region to region to region. And the thing of it is that as it is moving, everyone is trying to figure out that how it is moving, how it is spreading, how this is happening, how this is happening. And everyone has an idea about what is going on. Some people say, wear a mask, stay 6 feet apart, and you'll be just fine. Others say, you don't need a mask, and you don't have to worry about social distancing. In fact, if we all come together and we all catch it together, we'll build up an immunity to it. But the thing of it is, how do we deal with this crisis that has come upon us because of this coronavirus? People have lost their jobs. Some have passed on to be with God. And so the question is, how do we react when faced with so many difficult situations in our lives? Situations that are beyond our control. You think you're doing the right thing, wearing a mask and all of these other things. We tried to do what was mandated. And yet, several of us, this is close to home, several of us ended up testing positive. But ironically enough, out of all the families that were involved in this, the close families that I'm speaking of, the Freedom in Christ families, we noticed that some households, everybody tested positive. Some households, only specific people tested positive. We learned that in the household, even if you tested positive, you didn't show symptoms. Some did. We learned that some showed symptoms much worse than others. We learned that some had to deal with the symptoms for a longer period than others. What we learned is we just don't know. That's what we learned from it. We don't understand the way that God moves and why he moves that way. Why is it that if all of us who tested positive, showed symptoms and whatnot, not a single person in that was hospitalized.
Hallelujah.
Not a single person in that lost their life.
Hallelujah.
When all around us, people are going to the hospital, people are passing on. I mean, there are families who, there was a family recently who lost 6 members within a matter of weeks to the COVID pandemic. Why is it that that particular family had people who passed on, and then there are other families who tested positive and had no symptoms, no suffering, yet they all contracted the same strain? And I say this because now there's a new strain of this virus. The thing is that when things like this happen, you can either react or act without knowing all the facts, which is what Joe's friends did. They didn't know what we have the privy of knowing, that Satan and God were in spiritual warfare. That the things that were taking place in Job's life had nothing to do with him in the physical, other than God labeled him as upright. Sometimes it's easy to react to things in a negative way while blaming everybody else, even the weather sometimes, for circumstances. Oh, this wouldn't have happened if that. This wouldn't have happened if that. If I only had done. Listen, what we are learning is that we have not the capacity to comprehend the things of God, which is what we read when we read Job 38? Turn with me to Job 38. Again, I didn't read the whole chapter of 38. But I believe we just start from 1 in 38, and we'll just read a few of them. But it says that finally after, this is not quoting from the Bible, this is my leaning into it. It says, finally Job and his friends and his wife went back and forth and back and forth and back and forth until finally the Lord spoke to Job out of the storm. He said, "Who is this that obscures my plans with words without knowledge?" He goes on to tell him, "Brace yourself like a man. I will question you and you shall answer me." And then he goes on and he says, "Where were you when I laid the earth's foundation? Tell me if you understand. Who marked off its dimensions? Surely you know. Who stretched a measuring line across it?" And we'll stop there. Basically, what God told Job is that this is not for you to understand. And we understand now, once we read all the way to the end, we understood that it was not for Job to understand. Because God never explained it to him. God never told him, "Listen, Job, this is happening to you because I have been dealing with Satan. And Satan has brought all these things upon you. And I allowed him to do these things because I needed to prove to him that there was at least one upright and righteous man." And so, we read that in the end, God restored everything, but he never explained it to Job. Why? Because it was beyond Job's comprehension. Today, when we see things happening, much like Job saw things happening, we have a better understanding because we have the Word. And the Word told us prior to what happened to Job and what happened at the end of Job. And you see that God never revealed to Job why these things happened. But he still rewarded him in the end for his faithfulness. One of the things that we know is that both courses of action show us that one must not jump to conclusions when something happens and appears to be going wrong in our life. We can't just up and say, "Oh, this happened because of this." In fact, growing up, my family were superstitious. And I've come to understand that the superstition is just man's way of trying to explain things that happen. Maybe there's some people out there who experience some of the same things, like sweeping your foot with a broom. If you didn't spit on that broom, you were going to jail. Hanging your purse, letting your purse be on the floor means that you'll always be broke.
Yep.
Putting your shoes in a place that is above your head means that you would die. There are so many things that were superstitious that we use to attribute to the things that were happening in our lives. Hallelujah. Don't walk under a ladder, it's bad luck. Don't break a mirror. All these things that we try to figure out so that we can explain the unknown.
Yeah.
Don't step on that crack. Why? Because you'll break your mama's back.
Yeah.
Now, as a kid, I played that game. Don't step on the crack or you break your mama's back. But you remember, there was a time when my mother upset me. And so I would step on the crack. And it didn't happen, y'all. It did not happen. Yet it did not stop me from believing that if you step on the crack, you'll break your mama's back. It wasn't until recently that I stopped spitting on a broom if somebody hit my foot with it. And y'all know I've been in jail enough times to believe that might have been a truth. Certain events happen in our lives without our knowledge of what's behind it. That's like us right now. Now that we know the story of Job, every time something goes wrong, we have to say to ourselves, well, God must have gave me over to Satan. Even that would be an incorrect assumption. Maybe God has something for you at the end of the suffering. Maybe there is something there for you that you have to go through. Sometimes God will place you in certain situations that no man can explain. And it only brings you around to just trust God. Just trust God. We might not know or ever be aware of the unseen forces at work behind the scene. But the Bible clearly says, for our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. That's in Ephesians 6 and 12. Ephesians 6 and 12. We don't know, but we're constantly trying to battle this thing in the fleshly realm, when it is clear to us that no matter what it is, whether God and Satan are having a conversation about our loyalty, or whether God just has a path for us and needs to move us out of the direction that we're heading into another direction, we don't know. It makes it clear, though, that our struggle is not against flesh. In other words, we're not warring against one another. We're not capable in the flesh of comprehending what is going on. But if we trust God in the spiritual realm, if we trust God with all that is going on in our lives, God will deliver us from whatever we think we're going through.
Thank you, Lord.
God will make a way for you to live an abundant life. But sometimes you just got to go through what you got to go through. A while back, I preached a sermon about going through a storm, how I was traveling on a road. And as I was traveling on this road, ahead of me, I could see the storm. But as I looked to the left and to the right, sunshine was abundant. But the problem is that if I had gotten off that road and drove towards the sunshine so that I could try to go around this storm, it would have taken me so far off course that I would have never made this delivery in time. So I had to keep pushing through the storm. That is a daily lesson. You have to keep pushing through the storm. Whatever is thrown at you, whether it is Satan who is testing you, or whether it is God who is diverting you because there is something better for you on the other side of this, you have to keep pushing forward through your storm. Something can happen in someone's life that is not in a response to a person or people doing something wrong in their lives. You know, one of the things that we do, especially us Christians, is that we pray against someone. We pray that God would bring about some type of calamity in this person's life and then attribute that calamity to the wrong that they did to us. In other words, we pray to God that he would strike that person and then let that person know that this happened to them because they messed with us, a child of God. But what if that other person is a child of God as well? You see, the thing of it is that we have a way of trying to attribute things to our own understanding. If this went wrong in your life, it had to be because of this. There has to be a catalyst of why these things are going wrong in your life. And that is, to a certain extent, true. There is a catalyst. There's a reason why these things happen. As you read in the book of Job, there was a conversation that took place. The problem with us is that we try to figure it out. This is why. Job's friends came to him and said, "Surely you have sinned against God. Otherwise, this would not happen to you." They said to Job that God does not strike people with calamity who are upright. You had to have sinned. And they couldn't be more wrong. The current crisis that we're in falls into that category. Oh yeah, people try to blame it on other things. People have come up with ideas that subject the present pandemic to all kinds of conjectures. I use a couple big words in there every now and then. I'll post some stuff in there. In other words, the blame game is on. They are blaming different things for different reasons. Some of them that I've read through in all the news and heard on all the news, and you see on the YouTube videos that come out and have been posted, they say that they blamed it on the food and eating habits of the Chinese, the greenhouse effect. They blamed it on the Bill Gates Foundation, to George Soros. And then they've even said that this was something that was done to make sure that President Trump didn't get reelected. You see, people have a way of wanting to have an answer for everything. And then when it doesn't work out the way you think in your mind, then you still have to find a scapegoat. You have to find someone to blame this on. When all along, this is possibly a part of God's plan. How could this be a part of God's plan? How can anybody accept the fact that this could be a part of God's plan? Well, we've talked about some things that go against our thinking, but were a part of God's plan. One of the greatest was when Judah betrayed Jesus. You go, but Judas is... He's this bad person. Sure he was, in our mind. but he fulfilled something that God needed him to do. Why would God want his own son to suffer? But it all comes out because, like I said, we get to read the whole book. So then we understand that God allowed his son to suffer on our behalf. There was something in that suffering that was for us. There was a lesson to be learned as well. But there was something in it for us to give us our everlasting life, an opportunity to spend eternity with God. Some people still today believe that without doing wrong or doing without doing any wrong, no evil can come to us. We're immune to evil if we've done no wrong. Wrong again. The things that we're talking about here, the studying of what happened with Job, many people still hold this opinion, this view, because we're trained early to believe that evil will always follow after any wrongdoing. So our mindset is fixed on the idea that when evil happens, it's because of something we have done in the past. Oh, I know I'm not the only one, hallelujah, who has sat down in their life at some point when they were going through something and tried to figure out what it is that they did. How many people have gone and fallen on their knees and prayed to God, Lord, whatever I did, please forgive me. Remove this from my life. But you see, that is part of the purpose. That when you're going through something, that you would stop and you would fall to your knees and that you would pray and you would trust God to remove that situation, to get you out of a situation, maybe lessen the effects of the situation that you're in. I know while I was going through this COVID thing, I was praying to God constantly, Lord, please take this away from me. My head was hurting. My body was hurting. I was coughing. Everything that I could think of in a complaint was pretty much there. And I just wanted God to remove all of these things from me. I didn't want to wake up, because when I woke up in agony. So I just wanted to sleep. Lord, just let me sleep. Let me sleep through this. But as I said, when I was at that stoplight and I looked behind me, I began to praise God, because God answered my prayers, not in the way that I would have wanted him to, but he answered my prayers. You see, I didn't go to the hospital and I wasn't put on a ventilator, and I did survive. Hallelujah. So he answered my prayers, but I still had to go through some things. There's a thing called Murphy's Law. It says that if something can go wrong, it will. And it usually goes wrong at the worst possible time. But answer me this one. Would there ever have been a good time for this pandemic?
Nope.
This coronavirus, it doesn't fall within that Murphy's Law thing. You see, because it wasn't whatever can go wrong, will go wrong. It was just, it went wrong. The example of Job that we have been studying is a classic example of how this disproves the human hypothesis of something happening that must be tied to one's actions. In other words, you cannot tie what's going on in your life to a specific action. You cannot attribute bad in one's life to something that they have done, just like you cannot do something good to receive a blessing. You can't do something, or you can't attribute something that's happening in your life to something that you've done. Sin is sin. And so when you understand that we're all sinners, then we should all be running around here with boils all on our body from head to toe. He said that he took a piece of pottery and was scraping at the sores because he was suffering so much. The thing is, he stood his ground, though. And he went back and forth for his friends. His friends were accusing him of wrongdoing and hiding his crimes. In other words, they were saying that you act like you're upright. Well, you walk around here like a man of God, but you must have done something wrong. You're hiding what you did. But you see, God sees everything. But Joel, he continued to go against that thinking. And his friends stood their ground. They said they continued to claim that Job is sin. And they continue to find the reasons for the justification of his suffering. Why are you suffering? Well, I'm suffering because there must have been a reason. Even in all of it, his wife encouraged him to curse God. And this all went on until God spoke, as we just read in 38. And I encourage everyone to read the entire book of Job. But God always has a way of setting the record straight. He knows what, when, and how. Nothing escapes his omniscient knowledge. Nothing escapes him. And so when you look at the trying to link things, these plagues and calamities and things that are going on of the world, when you try to link them with a wrongdoing, you're always going to come up short. Always. But sometimes things may be different, and we don't have any knowledge of why it's different. Things happen to people that we think are good people. We say, how could this happen to such a good person? Why would God allow this person who we believe is such a good person to go through something? We don't know that God is punishing that person, but we have already assumed that if this is happening in your life and God is allowing it, that God must be punishing you. But it's not always that. God knows. Only God knows. So then when something is going wrong, what do we do? Well, here's some of the things that I believe we can do. First, you believe in the power of the Lord our God and our Savior Jesus Christ over the weakness of whatever crisis you're going through, because God is sovereign over all. Turn with me to Joel 26, and we're going to read 7 through 14. 7 through 14, it says, he spreads out the northern skies over the empty space. He suspends the earth over nothing. He wraps up the waters in his clouds, yet the clouds do not burst under their weight. He covers the face of the full moon, spreading his clouds over it. He marks out the horizon on the face of the waters, for a boundary between light and darkness. The pillars of the heaven quake against his aghast at his rebuke. By his power he churned up the sea. By his wisdom he cut Rahab to pieces. By his breath the skies become fair. His hand pierced the gliding serpent.
And these are but the outer fringes of his works. How faint the whisper we hear of him. Who then can understand the thunder of his power? Who can understand the thunder of his power? You see, we're all listening for that quaint whisper. We're all listening for that good stuff that comes from God. But what about that thunder of his power? No one wants to deal with that. In fact, we always want to explain it away. Well, you can't. You just have to trust in the Lord with all your heart and not in your own mind. Proverbs 3, 5, and 6, it says, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways submit to him, and he will make your path straight. Lean not to your own understanding. Stop trying to figure out the things of God, the things that God and Jesus are only privy to. Even Satan himself is not privy to this. Now, Satan knows the word of God, but he's not even privy to the things that are going on in God's mind, the reason that things are taking place. Remember, we walk by faith, not by sight. 2 Corinthians 5 and 7. And in closing, I'm going to say this, and remember this. Be thankful for the grace of God in your everyday life. Try to find the little things to be thankful for. For that can help you cope through a crisis. Whatever we're going through now, just keep in mind that it could be worse. It could be worse. Even if you've lost a loved one. I know that's hard. That's one of the hardest things to accept in our lives, is losing a loved one. And then when we look at it, we say we lost a loved one, and we lost them senselessly to this COVID. Again, we've fallen into the thinking of the human being. Understand that God has a plan and God has a purpose for all of us. And none of us have the wisdom to discern what it is that God is doing in our lives, why he would call someone home based on this pandemic, why he would call someone home, or why he would let someone be tested positive and not exhibit one symptom from it. Don't try to think for God. Just trust God. Allow God to work in your life in a way that folks would see and know the glory of God is upon you. That's all that we can do. I pray for those who have been afflicted with it, whether lives have been lost or just testing positive sometimes is a scary enough event. But I pray that as we move forward, as we go into a new year, as we have found that the scientists have come up with a vaccination for COVID, I pray that through all of this, that we would continue to trust in God. Oh, whether you take the vaccination or not, that's up to you. But if you take it, you're taking it because you trust God. If you don't take it, you're not taking it because you trust God. Your relationship with God is something that no one else will ever be able to label. No one else will be able to judge the level of the relationship that you have with God. And so anything that you do, please do it from a trusting God standpoint. Amen? Amen. I thank everybody for joining in with us, and I now turn it over to Nikki for the closing.
Amen. Amen, church. Amen. 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 It could always be worse. That's what I said. Praise him now while you have the breath to praise him, because he did keep you. He kept you and protected you this entire time. Praise him now while you still have a chance to. Amen.
Yeah.
Amen. It's time for announcements. Wednesday night Bible talk. Wednesday night Bible talk will be this Wednesday at 7 p.m. Our last Bible talk for the year 2020. So please, if you're able, join us. You can find us on Band, Periscope, YouTube, Facebook. Please join us for Bible talk, the last one of 2020, this Wednesday at 7 p.m. Youth group. Youth group is going virtual after the beginning of the year. I don't have a set date yet, but it's going virtual. So if you haven't already, please, if you want your child to participate, please get your child's phone number and email address to Minister Brandy or to Pastor Danny so they can get the links out to use for the virtual youth group, which will be on Tuesdays still. Still Tuesdays? Yeah. Tuesdays. But we'll have more information for you as we get a date, a start date for that. But get your child's email and phone number to Minister Brandy or to Pastor Danny if you want them to participate in the virtual youth group starting after the first of the year. Our watch night service this year, watch night is virtual this year on Microsoft Teams. It will be December 31st at 10:30 p.m. You're able to get the link from Facebook, Band, I believe it's on YouTube as well, or you can contact myself or Pastor Danny. We'll be able to email you the link for the virtual watch night service. So if you're able to join us, if you can, get your own bottle, because we're not going to be together. Get your own bottle of apple cider or what do we use? Sparkling apple cider. Get your own bottle of sparkling apple cider so we can do that toast at midnight together, apart together. We'll be toasting in the new year. Amen. Amen. So once again, I love you guys. Thank you so much for joining us today. Continue to watch, follow, please share these videos. Band, YouTube, Periscope, Facebook. We love you. We want to continue to encourage you. We want this ministry to continue to grow until we're able to come back together again. So love you guys. See you Wednesday at 7 p.m. for our last Bible talk of 2020, and then again on Thursday, December 31st at 10:30 for our virtual watch night. Continue to build your hope on things eternal. We love you. Till next time. Bye-bye.